Hello. Today we are in conversation with Mr. Jawahar Sarkar, who is an acclaimed IAS officer with a career of more than 42 years as a civil servant with the Government of India. He is currently a Rajya Sabha MP with the Trinamool Congress and is also famous for writing varied research papers and doing a lot of research on the history of India. Sir, we would like to welcome you. We would like to understand that working in such difficult conditions and working as a bureaucrat for about four decades, you must have come across a lot of times when you had to make difficult decisions. We would like to know that which were those difficult decisions and any significant moments in your career that really, really moved you or you cannot forget till now.
There have been many such decisions in my career, and one of them came very late. You see, I was made industry secretary of West Bengal by Mr. Buddhadev Bhattacharya, who was a very dynamic chief minister at that point of time, at 49 years of, nearly 50 years of age, which is pretty young. I mean, it's a very important post. But within 3 to 4 years, I realized that the industrial policy that we were headed for was not the best available. And therefore, as industry secretary, it was my duty to explain to my government where improvements were possible, where better options were possible. Okay, I'll be a little more blunt. This is about, let us say, Nano and Singur, a place you must have heard of, or Nandigram, and an Indonesian company that disappeared like black magic. So, I mean, there are these incidents where I felt a little strongly. And obviously, I was outnumbered. I was outnumbered not by politicians, but by fellow bureaucrats who were falling over each other to tell the government how right they were. They were in the government was. I mean, this is something that I've got a little used to. And I felt that the best option for me would be to leave my state. Leaving a state at the age of 54 is not the finest of options. You've left behind, your father is old, your mother is old. I never saw my father up in the proper sense after that because he died. So you are leaving your family, you're leaving everything and coming to a place at an age which is not the, you're not a spring chicken anymore. And people ask only one question, ki kon khet ki mooli ho yaar? Aap kaise pahunch gaye? You know, people ask, and then you have to start your career once again from additional secretary, then if you're lucky, you become secretary, then you move on. So it was a tough decision to leave everything, to leave my plants and to leave everything and come over. So that's one decision. And in hindsight, I'm glad I did. At that point of time, I was very angry with myself, very angry with everyone. Why did I have to leave? Why couldn't I stay back in my state and prosper? I realized that the regime would not listen to me. So it happened like this. Even then, as secretary, I had some problems with ministers, which became well known. But then there was no reason of hiding them. If you have a major problem of targets and goals and methods, it's time in your life you tell your mind out. You speak your mind. You're not indulging in sedition by speaking your mind out. Of course, under this government, everything is possible. Then even a CEO of Prasar Bharati, it was a very tough time, very tough time. The Ministry of INB, led by whoever was the minister, excepting Mrs. Ambika Soni, who was pretty much of a liberal person, almost every other minister and every secretary was saying, power go, power hamare haath se nikal gaye, power kheech ke lao. Ye Prasar Bharati ka daba ke rakho. This is not the spirit in which the Prasar Bharati Act was enunciated. It was meant for a lot of operational autonomy. And my fellow bureaucrats ensured that not 1 inch of operational autonomy was available. Now, if I had kept quiet and said that, yes, please go on and lord it over me, they would all have been very nice. But then I was supposed to be loyal to the job under the statute, under the Act of Parliament that I was entrusted. So it became a very bitter period, very, very bitter period. And at 62, 64, you don't like to indulge in bitterness with others. But, well, yeah, either you put up with a lot of injustice, put up with a lot of what I would call completely unjustified acts, or you speak out.
So, sir, you have been a fighter, and throughout your career as a civil servant, you have locked horns with a lot of politicians. Then we are curious to know, why politics, sir, and why did you join it?
I didn't join it so deliberately, because as I've said before, if politics was my first target, I could have done it at 60. I could have just refused Prasar Bharati and taken on to politics, which would have been more interesting. But I didn't think of it as a first choice. I put it this way, that my genes are more on the analytical side, not an war action hero. I'd much rather be correct and proper rather than be rewarded and improper. So I kept on with my stubborn point of view, and my friends were distressed at my, what they considered, my unnecessarily endangering myself. They kept on threatening, saying, "Yaar, tujhe tere ko jail mein dalenge, Tihar mein dalenge." I said, "Come and meet me in Tihar once in a while. Ab agar jaan hai hai, to jalenge. Isme kya hai?" I mean, like, so they kept on saying that, why can't you be a little more compromising, a little more tolerant. I said, look, let's leave it at this age. Agla janam mein dekha jaye. We'll see about this. So one, if you stick on to what you consider right, then there's one section of the people that come around you, may not be right in front, may not be giving you, hands up and, thumbs up and everything. But obviously, there is some amount of support, and a lot of people who don't support you and give you all sorts of galis. Incidentally, there's a party I know that feeds on trolls, hundreds and thousands of them, and their only interest of trolling is that they may be a respectable doctor or whatever, they may be illiterate. Many of them are really illiterate. They can let out their poison within their hearts by taking on a target that has been approved by X or Y. So I have been on the receiving end. So I know the amount of gadis they give. It's all on record. I don't need to say anything. It's all on record. You open Twitter and you will see the extent of abuses that they have hurled. So not everyone is pleased. Many are violently displeased. Many are very worried about you, and a large section supports you. Now, you do it because you feel it is correct to do it, not because of either fear of trolls or because of what X can do and send you to which jail.
So, sir, basically, now that you talked about analysis and understanding the political matrix of the country, that is a very big interest area for you. So a lot of political analysts have started talking about Mamata Banerjee as an alternate to our current prime minister, and they're looking at her as a national leader. So what do you have to say on that?
See, Mamata Banerjee has never projected herself in that light. It's not known to be. The more important question is that immediately after coming, the hero of 2002 Gujarat riots, after he came to Delhi, the first thing that he did along with his friend from Gujarat or whatever, lackey from Gujarat, was to spread complete disarray in the opposition ranks. raids, disproportionate assets, arrests, vagare, 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 are unleashed on each and every party that was opposed to them. There is not a single party of consequence in India that has not faced raids, that has not faced income tax inquiries, that has not faced ED, Enforcement Directorate. Do you know why the Enforcement Directorate is used? Enforcement Directorate is used because in most states, the CBI is not allowed by the state government. They have the power. So they come in through the back door with an Enforcement Directorate. Now, Enforcement Directorate is meant for smuggling and meant for laundering of money. Now, what does a, let us say, a sand racketeer have to do with laundering of money abroad? But they do all these ridiculous things to bring terror into the hearts of the opposition parties, and it worked by constantly pretending that he is a class apart, a person who has not been able to face a single press conference in 7 years, talks of his Mann Ki Baat. Yaar, Mann Ki Baat kehna hai to press conference pe kaho na. प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंस पे कहो इसलिए कि यू कैन एटलीस्ट गेट अ फ्यू क्वेश्चंस बैक. मन की बात रेडियो लाउड स्पीकर द रेडियो माइक्रोफोन डजंट स्पीक बैक टू यू. सो आई मीन हुम आर यू ट्राइंग टू फूल. सो अ पर्सन हु इज सो ऑब्सेस्ड विद हिज कल्टिवेटेड मैनिक्योर्ड पेडिक्योर्ड एंड कंट्रोल्ड एंड डॉक्टर्ड इमेज is always on the lookout to see that there is no opposition against him. And opposition can be dealt with in fairly, which is hardly ever done, or by terror. So he has used terror. Now, coming back to this Mamata Banerjee question, Mamata's spectacular victory in West Bengal has given a new energy to politics in India. And if Bengal, a state that was gone, think of your position in the month of March. You were told that's a question of 210 out of 294 seats or 225 out of 294 seats. You were also given the figure. The speculators were given the figure. The Satta Bazaar was given the figures. So everyone was convinced that it was just a matter of numbers. And your nose was cut like the proverbial Sutnakha in Ramayana. And you went back bleeding, but you went back bleeding, and before you put your first aid, you started screaming, saying, "Wah, presidents rule kar do. Wah, presidents rule kar do." Bada khatarnak state hai. Now, Mamata Banerjee came in with this new dose of energy because she is a street fighter. She has fought her way up. She's not a theoretical analyst like me. She does less of this pontification, more of action. So she became a rallying point, and she keeps on saying that her main purpose is to give energy and become a rallying point to the opposition to come together. In fact, today there was this meeting of Sonia Gandhiji with 18 or 19 opposition parties. It was unthinkable 1 year ago. Had it not been that Bengal's formula is now available to every other state to replicate. Tamil Nadu has shown in its own way that it can snub the ruling party out, ruling party of India out. Kerala has given a two-time victory to the Marxists to show that it doesn't want them. But Bengal screamed out, saying that, didn't say that please go, they said get out, get out. Do not disturb the plurality of Bengal.
Yeah. Should we then believe that actually this is a correct analysis that Mrs. Banerjee, Ms. Banerjee, sorry, is the actual face we should look out for in terms of maybe taking up a national leadership role?
She is already chief minister of a state, and therefore a lot of time is engaged there. She is not irresponsible like a person with a long beard who spent most of his time in Bengal and lost out on the COVID battle of India to prove his ego. He doesn't do it. She comes to Delhi for a very limited time. And after the elections, I think she came only for 3 days. She's not here for 40 hops in 2 months. she has her own business cut out, but if she can pass on that spirit of taking them on fearlessly, one good quality about her, even her worst enemies will say that she's fearless. She's full of energy and fearless. If these two can be passed on to certain opposition parties, jo ghabre gaye, ghabrahat se nikal gaye. I mean, don't worry so much. Raid will happen. This will happen. Her ministers were arrested within 2 days of her coming to power. So, I mean, these things will happen, but ultimately, we'll all get out of it. These things happen.
There was a question. There was a very violent kind of a fight that broke out immediately after the elections ended in Bengal, and there was a victory of TMC. A lot of people at that time blamed the government, which was elected at that time, that was Ms. Banerjee's government, for the kind of outburst that happened. So, sir, would you like to give us some more information on your opinion, your side of the thought process on this?
See, there was some amount of violence, which is sure from the evidence that is shown. And this inquiry that the courts have ordered through two different lines, one of a CBI, the other of the special investigation team of the West Bengal police, prove how much of it was correct. Now, violence took place, but who was the one who set it up? That's a question people would like to ask.
Yes.
You have to understand that there was no government at that point of time. Whoever selected it, selected the best time. Election results have been announced. The election commission is still in overall charge. A proper government has not come to power. And within that cusp, a lot of jhamela happened. Now, if the inquiries are held properly, it will come out who started it where, and who did what. The rest of it is speculation. The rest of it is a narrative purposely sold in Delhi by two very bad losers. They have never lost anywhere. You see, when you go back like two Surpanakhas with two handkerchiefs on your two bleeding noses, you do something. You can't go back and say, I was bumped against a wall and both of us lost our nose. Everybody knows where you lost your nose, and you had to have a credible, how can you have the temerity to file a petition in the Supreme Court against a 48% voting rejection by the people of Bengal? Ki is government ko hata do. Look at the type of audacity that comes from well-bred, inbred fascism. Look at the type of audacity. What is 48%? Let me explain. Mr. Modi came to power and ooh la la for the rest of India in 2014 on 31% vote. And the difference between 31 and 48 is 17% more. For every swing of half a percentage, Pranoy Roy and others go on twirling their chins and discussing with maps. Yeah, half a percent swing this way, 1% swing that way. And you know what 17% extra swing means? The people of Bengal were completely fed up with this politics of poison that Modi and Amit Shah were coming and injecting. And they had made up their minds to be quiet, to say whatever the opinion polls wanted to hear. But when the actual opinion poll came out through the EVM button, dikha diya how to throw out communal elements from a democratic plural state.
So there is no doubt that Mamata Banerjee actually took the entire election in her stride very well, and she was the one who actually swamped, and she kind of, took away the entire limelight, and she was deserves to. But then when we look at BJP performing in Bengal, they have performed much better than what they were performing earlier. And if you look at Congress and left, I mean, the performance of Congress has been very miserable, and they have lost everything now. If you talk about Congress and other parties, And BJP has still been able to get some seats there. So what do you have to say on that?
It speaks of the democracy of Bengal, the democracy of the democratic nature of the people of Bengal, that they speak their mind out. They wiped off the left, they wiped off the Congress, they showered their votes either on the Trinamool Congress, which went alone, 48%, or if they were cut up with the government, that is bound to happen after 10 years of incumbency, they voted against the government with the BJP. So 38% of the vote with BJP is not a thing that you can sort of ignore. 38% of vote is something you can't ignore. But the question is, how much of it is because I have communalism deep in my soul? How much of it is because I'm angry with the local representative of the government? How much of it is because I don't like the chief minister? You have to do the salami slicing and come to a viewpoint. That will take a little time and we'll come to know.
So basically, I'm coming to exactly what you have finished your argument with. When you're saying that this victory will increase, the share of the victory will increase eventually. We also want to understand that what is Mamata Banerjee's victory and vision with respect to the future that you're talking about 2024 now. How is the TMC looking at creating a different kind of a story here, a different kind of path that they are looking for in 2024? What is the vision, sir?
You see, till 2021 elections, the picture was pretty bleak. The in three North Indian states, the Congress had come through with very thin majorities, and except one, nothing really lasted. Madhya Pradesh was bought over. As you know, they just simply bought over. So this happened, and Chhattisgarh, of course, proved that they had firmer numbers. The majority that the Congress got, except in Chhattisgarh, were very marginal. But here, the majority, the vote that Mamata Banerjee managed to get was phenomenal. The question is, do you have the confidence to take it on? Do you have the confidence to take it on? Because the entire mahol is against you. The newspapers, the Godi media keep saying, ye to gay, 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 gay. Iske baare baat mat karo. Don't waste your time. That narrative has been pumped in. So when you are up against a fight, when you are up to restore democracy, pluralism, secularism in India, you need to first tune your mind, strengthen your heart. I'm precisely repeating this point again and again, that it is where the fight begins with the heart. The second freedom struggle of India has begun from the hearts of the people. On the hearts of the people. So first on that, three states gave sweeping victories to their parties against the BJP. One gave in a more spectacular manner, but all three gave it in their own way. And that is a major step. Now we have 2022 UP polls. The polls that preceded the UP polls that have preceded the local body elections and others have shown a lot of disgruntlement against the UP government. So the target, we have to go in for one target at a time. The farmers' agitation means that the large parts of Western UP and Central UP are up in arms. Okay. Now, given these factors, if 2022, the UP government is, this government of UP receives its due setback, there is nothing stopping the rest of India from toppling Modi. His invincibility and his infallibility are both myths. Remember that.
So we would like to thank you so much for giving us your precious time today. And it was a wonderful, wonderful discussion, very insightful. We look forward to see you and have more such discussions with you in the future. Thank you so much for joining us.